And welcome to good morning, afternoon, evening, middle of the night, wherever you are, to session 6J on water quality treatment and security. We've got three papers to cover, one from Nepal, one from Rajasthan and India, and one from northern Pakistan. So we're going to be in the mountains, moving down into the desert and back up into the mountains. And with no further ado, we'll make a start with the first presentation, which Surendra will be here to take questions on. Thank you.
Good morning, afternoon, wherever you are. My name is Mikael Ashron. I'm from UNICEF Nepal, and I welcome you to this short presentation on the lessons we have learned by piloting a so-called water-safe community approach in Nepal. So today I will be giving you first a brief background, why was it done? Then I'm going to introduce you very shortly to what a water-safe community is and the process of establishing one. Finally, I'm going to just talk you through some of the major achievements we've had with this initiative and what we learned from it and what could the lessons and ways forward be. So let's start with the context. Nepal has made a significant progress in increasing access to basic water services. In 1990, only about 46% of the population had access, but by 2019, this number had grown to almost 95%. However, the water quality still remains a challenge, with the majority of the water samples being contaminated by E. coli. 76%, as you can see from the graph, of drinking water services meet two of the three sub-criteria of safely managed drinking water services. But only 19% of the drinking water services meet all of these three sub-indicators. So here, focusing on water quality could be a low-hanging fruit, and it could actually be a game changer. But focusing on quality hasn't been as easy as we thought. So from this context stemmed the approach of a water safe community, which is actually a community led process, and thus it kind of gives the community pride to have this water safe community status achieved. What is a water safe community? In a nutshell, a water safe community is a systematic approach and pathway to practically demonstrate the achievement of SDG 6.1, or at least access to basic plus drinking water services at a community and local level. There are some preconditions to be met before a community could officially be certified and declaring to become water safe. Majority of these are ODF status or open defecation free. They have to still be open defecation free and maintain that status. The water quality has to conform to national standards set by each government, and there has to be a sustainability and functional mechanism for water quality monitoring in place. If you then go to the more detailed processes of achieving water safe community, the slide is a little crowded, but there are seven steps in achieving water safe community. The major steps include operationalizing a water quality monitoring mechanism. This has to be done both at the community and local government level. Then there has to be a systematic implementation of a community-led climate resilient water safety plan. This means that the community actually has to come out with WSP. This is water safe plan. And this is the process of becoming a water safe community. The plan is something that we kind of systematize the approach, and we have a document that we can then go back and see if the end results go together with this plans. So the water safe community approach is the outcome, but without a systematic assessment and testing of water community, we can't guarantee that the drinking water is safe. So this is where the community needs to be actually externally tested and verified before they can actually declare themselves to be water safe. What are then the major achievements? The first water safe commune in Nepal was declared 29th of April in 2019. So this is a very, very new approach. And you can see in these photos, some of it includes building these kind of water infrastructure, but a lot of it is actually about the mechanisms and plants and something like this. So far, 49 communities have achieved the water safe community status, but this number in Nepal is really expanding rapidly. As then you can see in the next bullet point is that the guides and protocols for water safe communities and water quality monitoring mechanism, they're now in place. And now that they are in place, it is much easier to go and advocate to local governments that this is a good approach, as well as that it will actually give the results intended. And so far, 24 local governments, with municipalities called in some parts of the world, have these monitoring mechanisms in place. If you remember from the previous slides, the systematic external monitoring is a very, very crucial part of this approach. But as said, it is very, very new initiative. It's very local so far. So then there are some kind of scaling up strategies we have thought about. In Nepal, we have thought about these strategies to kind of be built on four pillars. These pillars would be lobbying on policy and financing, on strengthening the systems and institutional capacity to be actually able to implement this. Then it needs to be piloted on ground. And finally, we need to advocate. We need to show that it is a working approach that will give the results wanted and is worth the invested money. So based on these four pillars, we actually assume that this initiative will take on, because it has been demonstrated to be very successful so far. What we've learned so far is that the process of functional water quality monitoring mechanism at local government and community level is a must. Without this kind of monitoring mechanism, it is very plausible that after kind of declaring, the water quality will deteriorate fast. And this is one of the main parts that we don't want to happen. Another important thing we've realized is that the tests of the water quality tests need to be very, very easy to use, very cheap. In Nepal, we've used the same dry plate testing kits that has been used in the so-called multiple cluster indicator survey. There's a fast approach and well taken by the community, and people know how to use this. So based on this, we've proven that it kind of works in a rural setting. The next way forward is that UNICEF Nepal, together with the Nepali government, will be piloting the initiative in an urban context. In theory, the approach should work in the very same way. We can either call it a water safe community, or it can be called a water safe town or a water safe city or whatever. But the idea is that there is a systematic way written up in a plan, and then implementing that plan will result in a water safe community or a town, and keeping it up gives a sense of pride to the community itself. So let's see, this is what we're hoping that will happen. With that, I'd like to thank you for listening to this short presentation. I know it was very, very, very brief run through. But you can read more about it in our short abstract, and I would be very, very happy to answer any of your questions at mashorn@unicef.org. Thank you very much.
Danyabad, Mikael, and thank you for the update from your team. Mikael is not here, but Surendra has kindly agreed to take any questions. So if you've got any questions, please put them in the chat. While we're waiting, I do have one holding question, a typical academic one maybe, but having done my research in the past on the Indian subcontinent, not so much in Nepal, but in India in particular, the term community can be used quite a lot, but not always very well defined. So I just wondered, in this particular project, how community was defined. Was it based on geographical area, or was it based on different types of communities, such as related to caste or religious affiliation or ethnicity, for example? So could you expand a little bit on how communities were defined?
Thank you, Barbara Lee. Thank you for the question. In fact, you brought a very good point on defining the first step and the term community. Is you, anyone speaking? Maybe I couldn't.
Let's hope he will do it. After that, Mohsin sir, phone nahi utha rahe.
It will help if we can mute so that we can allow Surrender to answer the question.
I think so.
Please mute. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, good. I think, yeah, it's now clear. Okay. So this first thing is about defining community. Right? In communities can be defined in many ways in different contexts. For this particular initiative of water safe community, generally in our context, maybe it may be true in other contexts as well, that a community for water supply is a community where the people are served by that particular system or scheme or project of one water supply, right? So it could be a kind of heterogeneous or homogeneous. But in general, in our case, in the rural context of Nepal, there is homogeneous community where the people from the same caste, ethnicity, the background, they cluster together in one geographical area. But in principle, and then the way that we are seeing it, is a people served by one particular water supply system is defined as community for this particular matter.
Okay, thank you. We do have a question in the chat from Catherine. Can you just clarify again if the water safe community approach has been used anywhere else? It seems a great comprehensive approach. If Nepal is the first place it has been used, can you tell us more about how the approach was developed? Really good question.
In fact, very good question. And in fact, it opens up a lot of other questions further also. But to tell you, as it was shared in the presentation, this concept of water safe community was introduced in Nepal while we were planning to achieve the SDG 6.1, especially on safely managed water supply, where those three different elements, the water available on premises, available when needed, and free from contamination. I think it is universal for every country in the world like to have that goal achieved through SDG. And then we started talking internally with UNICEF and the government in Nepal, especially with the local government and also with the federal government. How do we achieve? Because it is really a challenging job, because as you could see in the presentation, only 19% of Nepali people are having access to safely managed water supply. See the gap. So then we started talking about it, whether it could be, there could be something pilot which could be replicated in other areas of Nepal, and also the rest of the world would also get benefit, the world where the context is similar to Nepal. Then we started talking in Nepal only first, and then we started talking in the region, the South Asian region. We had a discussion with our regional office, whether it could be replicable in other contexts in the region. And we found this like quite positive response. And then we start like again, talk with the headquarters where the office manages all the countries around the world. And then we came up with an idea of having one defined, but one publication. We call in UNICEF is a field note. The field note is now prepared from Nepal country office side, reviewed by the regional office and also approved by the headquarters, meaning it was consulted with many professional inside the organization and also the peer reviews, also the experts. Now the field note is approved and is already available in UNICEF site. We are hoping that this approach may work in other part of the world as well, because the world, the way that we define community, the way that we define the indicators of safely managed water supply, and the way that we are doing our water supply projects and the water quality improvement, almost similar in every context, maybe different in the, like in geography, if the water source is different or urban or rural, there are differences. But the approach, as we say, the community-led approach, where we have a lot of experience on sanitation, right? The community engagement for improved sanitation like CLTS or school-led sanitation or social movement. It is, we have a lot of learning from the sanitation area, right? That domain. Then why not it works in the water supply and improving water quality? We are very, very much hopeful, but it's still, we need to like see and get feedback from the areas where it is being piloted, it is being rolled out in other part of the world. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. So this is, so as Tamiz Ahmed has said, this is the first initiative piloted in Nepal. So there are plans. Are you working with any organizations to do some pilots in other countries? Because it sounds like a very good initiative.
Yeah, thank you very much, Lee. And thank you, Tamiz, for putting the big, in fact, Tamiz is one of our team members where he has put a lot of effort and then has brought a lot of knowledge from other part of the world also in terms of improving the water quality. And in fact, he is leading the whole initiative on our behalf. Thank you, Tamiz, for putting this thing. And you can already see some link in the chat box that Tamiz has put. And yes, Tamiz mentioned it is first piloted in Nepal. But in Nepal, at least we are confident that the government of Nepal, and in fact, particularly the municipalities, the local government, they are very much excited and they are developing the protocol and then developing the guideline on moving towards that direction. So as was mentioned in the presentation, about 24 municipalities in Nepal have already adopted this approach. And yes, in the presentation, you could see some 20,000 populations were benefited. Now the number has been doubled, and then maybe we are hoping that it will get increased in the time to come. Thank you very much.
Okay, that's great work. One last question from Shola. What are the priority chemicals tested as part of the water quality assessment?
Yeah, in fact, very good and very technical questions too. In Nepal, as defined by the government of Nepal, there are two parameters, like mandatory, non-negotiable, because there was a discussion around the SDG and the defining the SDG target for the countries. And Nepal came up with two parameters. One is biological, is E. coli, and the chemical is arsenic, because in the lowland of Nepal, there are a lot of issues around arsenic contamination. So arsenic is mandatory. It's not only in the lowland part, but also in the hills or in the mountainous part. So those two parameters are mandatory. In chemical is arsenic for Nepal.
Okay, thank you very much. You're happy with that answer, Shola? Thumbs up? Good. Okay, that's great. So what we'll do now, we'll move on to the next speaker, and we'll ask, I'll get that set up. So now we're moving from the lofty heights of the Himalayas in Nepal down to perhaps more arid context of Rajasthan in India. So this is our second presentation.
Greetings from India. My colleague Manjri and I, Rushabh, are happy to present our experiences and learnings on domestic water security in Rajasthan, a largest state located in northwestern part of India, with insights on gender, social inequity, and water management practices. The discussion is anchored in the discourse of Jal Jeevan Mission, an ambitious national government-led flagship program to ensure household water security initiated in 2019. It aspires to reach out to every household of the country with a functional household tap connection by 2024. in a diverse landscape of India with an equally large continuum of a socio-cultural and economic diversity. This dream will require participation and ownership of multiple stakeholders and interest to turn this into reality.
A case in point is Rajasthan, whose topography is shaped by the stretches of the Thar Desert in the west and the Aravali Hills in the south. The current coverage of tap connections in some of these areas is less than 5%. Scanty rainfall, lower groundwater table, compounded by water quality and fluoride issues, offers a layered challenge. A feudal past has rendered the society with multiple hierarchies and strong patriarchal beliefs. All of these physical and socio-economic constructs are reflected in the water management practices also.
Hence, in this context, before we embarked on a comprehensive strategy and implementation plan, we endeavored to map and analyze inequities of gender, caste, tribe, geography, among others, when it comes to access, availability, and adequacy of domestic water. A logical starting point was also to study prevailing practices, current barriers, and enablers at both normative and individual beliefs level. These insights were meant to be plowed back into development of an equity-focused, gender-transformative, multi-stakeholder strategy for the state aligned to the National Jal Jeevan Mission.
We went with a qualitative research methodology, including transect walks, focus group discussions, interactive exercises, and triangulated these with very enriching life cycle stories of elderly women. Especially in desert districts of Barmer and Jaisalmer, water has been such a prominent and integral part of the lives of women that when you visit these parts of the world, you find innumerable folk songs sung by women on water and their lives in incidences around water. So the structural framework of our inquiry rested on these three pillars: water management practices, equity, and gender. As you can see, these are further unpacked into various relevant tenets. The interactions in the field confirmed that the three pillars were not operating in silos and are interrelated. In fact, larger the overlap, the greater the vulnerability. With a long medieval history in the state, social inequities manifested in who controlled the water resources. These in turn had an implication on distance, resource, and time invested in accessing them. With the burden of water sourcing being shouldered by women largely, the implications of these were also borne more intensively by them. Naturally, this also meant that the time and resources left with women for other aspects of their lives, such as education, health, economic engagement, got adversely affected. The patriarchal dynamics were evident when we saw the investment of resources in implements such as carts, bikes, etc., were evident only when the responsibility shifted to men. Otherwise, the traditional image of women carrying pots on their heads was common. More such sightings on the fringes of the villages where the most disadvantaged communities traditionally resided than the center where the more empowered ones were located. With a growing dependence on the government for water, unfortunately, the traditional wisdom of water management is beginning to fade. Currently, the availability of potable water continues to be inconsistent and irregular, with a huge implication on the expenses on water per se.
Water management plays an important role in ensuring domestic water security right from source up to household level. Rajasthan had traditional practices on harvesting rainwater due to its unique situation of low rainfall condition. However, with the changing use of water, limited yet gradual access to government water supply, the traditional practices are a part of dying wisdom. To ensure sustainability of the water supply, it is imperative to promote conjunctive use of water. Traditional, local, and external surface water sources with an aim to reduce dependence on overexploited groundwater sources. This will contribute in strengthening climate resilient practices, particularly on water resource management. This study brought some key learnings pertaining to water management practices in the areas that have been highlighted in the slide. I would like to highlight a few of them. Groundwater source remains major source of water supply with the maintenance of water infrastructure in need of regular upkeep and attention. The villages in the tail end face double deprivation, which leads to domestic water stress. This also promotes unregulated private water markets, which may be of substandard quality, adding to additional financial burden as well as compromise on health in the long run. With regard to community practices, as a community level, the local water tank, which has contributed in domestic water security, with a changing lifestyle and overall improvement in quality of life, the domestic water consumption has also increased up to 3 times over last 2 decades. With regard to water governance, the study revealed that there is a need to activate and strengthen local village level committees. Community involvement and ownership, especially that of women, was very limited, thus promoting external contract-driven processes.
In spite of availability, water accessibility is influenced by various factors like gradient, terrain, scattered habitations, marginalization, and so on. People with disabilities and women-headed families faced multiple disadvantages. A vulnerability analysis confirmed that the landless ended up being excluded by default for most water-related schemes. The poor ended up paying far more, with an estimated 10 to 18% of their total expenditure only on water. And then the burden is further exacerbated due to the health impact of the poor quality of water that is available to them. The Jal Jeevan Mission aspires for a gender transformative approach to water management. However, the shift up the ladder from being gender blind to eventually transformative is dependent on 2 levels largely. The community level, that is guided by its pre-existing social norms, stereotypical roles and practices, and at the systemic level, which is restricted by capacities and governance, and that has a limited women's perspective in it by and large across board. Even if the policy is designed to be transformative, challenges lie in its implementation and sustained emphasis. In spite of having generations of experience and insights on best use of water, women are poignantly absent in water-related decision-making at all levels. Leadership and presence of women on the table is negligible or at best tokenistic. A systemic investment is required to enhance the capacities of women to voice their concern and of the collective for their ability to actively listen to them.
A consolidated view of the barriers and enablers across all 3 pillars reveal that poor capacities were existent at all levels. Lack of conjunctive use of water resources, neglect of traditional indigenous water harvesting practices and knowledge. Also limited inclusion of voices and concerns of women and the marginalized population was at the very center of the challenge. However, the silver linings were offered by the gradual yet consistent shift in the policy itself, with Jal Jeevan Mission being anchored in transformative process. The household storage mechanism of tanks were the game-changing assets, and increased private participation could be further organized for synergistic results. Our study led us to key inferences around these barriers and enablers. Promotion of conjunctive use of water and water conservation initiatives, strengthening governance and community ownership mechanisms with a prominent role of women and disadvantaged communities. This would be possible only with focused investments in capacities enhancement at all levels. And finally, in keeping with the current context of an active private and individual enterprises, the merit lies in developing a framework to regulate and systematize private players and micro-entrepreneurship.
With these insights in place, UNICEF Rajasthan is engaging with state government to carve out a pathway that ensures domestic water security through equitable, gender transformative water management practices. Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much for that presentation. I'll invite Rushabh to join us. If there's any questions, yeah, we've got one from Catherine already. Rushabh, is everything okay? I know you've had a few technical glitches.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, but I am unable to hear, so I think there's some problem. So if there are questions in the chat box, then maybe I can respond to the questions. I'm unable to hear. There's some problem with the system.
A minute.
Okay, I'm unable to hear you, Lee, but I've seen that there's a question from Catherine.
Okay.
So let me start by answering that question. And if there are any other questions, I would request other attendees to kindly put it in the chat box. So thank you. So in terms of the systemic approach, particularly, Catherine, as you know about Rajasthan being a water-stressed state, there is also the national flagship program, which is very ambitious, and it's looking at reaching all households with functional household tap connection by 2024. And it does outline the particular aspects of equity and gender within the programming outlay. As it was mentioned in the presentation setting, this is a water stress state, so it required a systemic approach to reach to the last mile. And for that, structural measures have been taken both by government and the civil society organization, and UNICEF has played a very important role in putting this whole programming in a perspective of how do we ensure that the key aspects of equity, affordability, accessibility is addressed. So that is something that has been kept as a part of the programming. It's the second year of programming. There are two more years to go. So we are hoping that it will gradually accelerate and these aspects will be addressed. And UNICEF is also documenting some of these learnings from very difficult area. So that is also going to feed into the state strategy that is under implementation. Okay, thank you. So this question from Lee. In terms of exclusion, there are kind of multiple deprivations that was highlighted in terms of the landless, in terms of also the habitation settlement patterns are such that they are located, the concentration is by a particular community or a caste. So generally the fringe areas in a village, which are mostly remote, do have, or they are mostly the tail end villages, or tail end of the village, do have issue of exclusion. But the program guidelines, they talk about making it more inclusive. So even if it means providing additional resources or additional provisioning of water, that is a part of the guideline. But when we look at ground implementation, there are going to be some challenges from the early results. Is my voice clear, Lee? Okay, thank you. Sorry for the technical glitch with the Okay, so in terms of the 55 LPCD, this has been recently revised in the recent national guidelines. It used to be 40 liters per capita per day. So this is a gradual increase in terms of availability. And as I was answering in my earlier question, so there would be, if we look at the most marginalized and the most excluded, probably no, the gap would be wider in terms of availability of water. There's a possibility that the current availability would be just about 30 to 40 liters per capita per day, or in some cases even lesser. So this is something that will have to be seen over a period of time. Also, in terms of the water scarcity, so Rajasthan is actually located in the northwestern part of India, which is one third of the state is the Thar Desert, which we share with our neighboring country, Pakistan. So it is a water scarce area, and particularly the study area, Bardmer and Jaisalmer, are the regions which has the lowest rainfall across India. So it gets about annual average rainfall is about less than 200 mm per year. So it is a scarce. And this is coupled with water quality issues too. So the groundwater which is available also has salinity and fluoride as an issue. Thank you very much.
Leo, we can hear you.
Yeah, sorry for thank you for your for taking the questions as I put in the chat, and sorry about the technical issues, but we'll keep up the great work. Sounds like a very interesting project, but we'll move on to the next speaker now. But thank you. Right, okay, let's move this over. And we'll get the next presentation up. So, last but not least, we're now moving from the arid edges of the Thar Desert in Rajasthan back up into the beautiful Himalayas in northern Pakistan.
Good day, everybody. I'm Dr. Manzoor Ali, Associate Professor at Saraipur International University and Head of the Physics Department. I'm a researcher of the project Scaling Up and Transferring Community-Managed Rural Water Systems to Urban Settings, funded by British Academy's Urban Infrastructures of Wellbeing 2019 program. This research was jointly carried out in Gilgit-Baltistan by Aga Khan University Institute for the Study of Muslim Civilizations, London, Karakoram International University, and Aga Khan Agency for Habitat in the year 2020-2021. Today's presentation, Water Quality Assessment of Community-Managed Rural Water Systems in Northern Pakistan, is part of the larger research project and based on work by Professor Dr. Attaullah Shah, Dr. Karamat Ali, Dr. Jeftain, and myself. Two agencies in Gilgit, Baltistan provide potable water to communities. First, WASA, Water and Sanitation Agency, which is government agency, and second, the Aga Khan Agency for Habitat, AKA, that implement the water and sanitation extension program in a community-based model of water management. The last WASIP water quality tests were conducted 20 years ago, and there is no evidence if water quality has been maintained. In the present study, it has been tried to find out whether, number one, the community-based water supply systems executed by AKA are able to maintain the quality of potable water. Number two, what's the role of the engineering design in maintaining both the quality and quantity of water? And number three, how it compares with the water supply systems developed by other agencies. This study examines whether A, have community-based WASAP water supply systems been able to maintain water quality in Gilgit-Baltistan? B, what's the role of the engineering design in maintaining water quality? Our research jurisdiction was entire Gilgit-Baltistan, consisting of 10 districts. The 25 rural and 25 urban WASI projects and 13 control sites were selected through proportional stratified sampling by district across 10 districts in Gilgit-Baltistan. An engineering sample of 12 rural projects and 18 urban projects was then generated from the rural and urban samples based on variations in engineering features, for example, gravity versus mechanical systems, total length of the pipe network, number of household connections, and then quota sampled by district group. Control sites were selected based on their location, proximity to WASIP rural and urban samples, and similarities in terms of engineering features. All the water supply systems were visited and interviews of water and sanitation committees were conducted. Quality scores range from 1 to 5 for water supply systems adopted on basis of various attributes like water source, water supply line, water tank design and capacity, water distribution network, water quality management, and water quality treatment. Water samples were obtained from the source, the system storage, and household tap in 9 WASIP villages and 2 control villages. The WHO guidelines were used for testing of various water samples. Tests were conducted on site and in the laboratory. WHO quality standards vary from A to D. Category A means 0 E. coli colonies per 100 ml of water. Category B means 1 to 10 E. coli colonies per 100 ml of water. And C means 11 to 100 E. coli colonies per 100 ml. And category D means 101 to 1000 E. coli colonies per 100 ml of water. Out of 12 sites, 9 villages were tested for microbiological contamination. The microbiological contamination test must start within 5 hours of the collection of sample. The samples from the 3 sites could not be tested because the travel time from these sites to lab was more than 10 hours and the field team did not have a mobile testing kit with them. This table shows that in water quality, all the 9 WASIP villages, that is 100%, fell in category A, means 0 E. coli detected. For water storage, 8 WASIP villages, which make 89% of the projects, fell in category A and 1 in category B. Results for water at the household tap reveal that 8 WASIP villages, 89%, fell in category A and 1 in category C. That means 11 to 100 E. coli colonies were detected per 100 ml of the sample. The reason of falling household tap water of Burushal in category C is that this project is around 20 years old. Because of the wear and tear of the pipes and walls, water in the system and household tap was found contaminated. Water quality results broadly correspond with engineering audit scores for the quality of water infrastructure. For water source, 100% of WASIP villages were in category A, with a quality score at an average of 4.25 out of 5 for each village. For water in the system storage, 89% of the WASIP villages were in category A, with the average quality of water distribution network scored at 4 out of 5. This table shows the quality of infrastructure and quality of water for control sites. In water quality, at the source, one control village came in category A and one in category B, that is 1 to 10 E. coli colonies found per 100 ml. Only one control village was tested for water in the system and fell in category B. At household tap, one control village was in category B and one in category D. That is, the number of E. coli were found between 101 to 1000 per 100 ml. The quality of water at the source in Semigal, which is in category A, corresponded with the quality of source of water intake score 4, while Doyen, category B, scored much lower for the quality of source of water intake. Overall, these results indicate that the WASIP model of community-based water management has been successful in maintaining WHO water quality, with engineering design being an important contributing factor. In comparison with the control sites and public water systems in Gilgit-Baltistan in general, WASIP rural drinking water supply systems are planned, designed, built, tested, and monitored to a higher standard. Where possible, water is sourced from springs at high altitude. Water sources are carefully selected to avoid contamination from human feces and livestock, with storage tanks and distribution lines protected. Water quality is tested and monitored at the source, and WASIP's technical team conduct disinfection of the storage tank, water supply network, and water conduits to remove any biological contamination before handing the scheme over to community. Water samples are then collected again from the tank inlet, outlet, storage tank, and communal tap stands to retest the water. Pipelines are buried 4 feet deep to prevent freezing and hence leaks and illegal connections that in turn also reduces the potential for contamination. HDPE pipes used provide flexibility and durability, further minimizing leaks and contamination. Finally, community ownership appears to be correlated with the regular maintenance of drinking water supply systems through active water and sanitation committees. Thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you very much for the presentation, Professor Shah. I'll invite you in to join myself and Sola. And if anybody's got any questions, hopefully we won't have any technical issues for this one. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Oh, we've got three for the price of one. Good to see you all.
Yeah, this is my team. My team here, they work with me, so I just wanted to show them also.
Oh, brilliant. Well, thank you very much for your presentation. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the chat and ask any of the questions that come up. So the first one is from Surendra in Nepal, who asks, is there any regular water quality monitoring mechanism established in the community managed water supply systems? And does the community have a role to play with the water quality tests? Are you still there?
Yes, can you hear?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you very much. In fact, there was no quality assurance system and testing system in the community when we visited at the time of this test, this study. But in the beginning, source was selected, there was a well-deployed testing system. And then periodically, the WASIP, which stands for Water and Sanitation Extension Program, the Aga Khan Habitat,
okay, we seem to have maybe a slight problem with the connection.
Yes. So the community does not have the capacity, but the WASIP, the AKA, is doing it periodically to test whether there is any problem with the water or not.
Okay. Thank you. Sola, do you want to field any more questions in the chat?
Yes. So we have a question from Tamiz Ahmad. This is a great study. WASIP received many global rewards for sustainable and integrated service delivery. The major issue in the northern Pakistan is the lack of systematic water quality monitoring mechanism by the government. What is being done in this regard? We can. I think it seems to have frozen again. We can hear you.
Yeah, sorry, that seems to be a a connection issue. Yeah, Professor, there seems to be a connection issue. We can't hear what you're saying.
We still can hear you.
Okay, what we might have to do is if the professor can provide maybe a contact email address in the chat, and if anybody's got any questions, maybe drop the professor an email, because it sounds like a very interesting and important study, and it'd be great to perhaps get some ideas, thank you, Professor, about how there can be a knowledge exchange, maybe particularly across the Himalayas, where in Nepal and even in parts of northern India, they're perhaps encountering similar problems as well. Thank you very much.
So very interesting. Very interesting work. It's a pity we can.
Yes, pity we've got a connection issue. But what I suggest, if anybody wants to find more about the project, is that you copy Professor's emails, he's kindly put his work and his private emails in, and drop him a line and continue the knowledge exchange that way. It's a pity that we haven't got a very good connection for the video and things. So what I suggest is we perhaps wrap things up, and also that might give you a bit of time to maybe follow up with the professor and his team directly afterwards. But on that, I just wanted to say, I know we're finishing a bit early, but hopefully we've got another session starting in 20 minutes time. So what I request is, well, first of all, thank you to the three presentations, all excellent, all very detailed, useful studies. We've been moving our knowledge on some great examples of some positive impacts from the research and the work that's been undertaken as well. So thank you for that, and it's been great to revisit some parts of the world that I haven't been to for a while. And thank you for some great questions as well. So what I'll do, I'll bring this session to a close now, and hopefully you'll have a chance to have a little bit of a break before the next session as well. But thank you all very much. Thank you, Shola, for your help, and see you again soon. Thank you.